they don't have to update them because they're old. Mm-hmm. And then just in terms of housing, they didn't have adequate accessible housing, which to me was, I wanted a place where I didn't have to walk down the hall to go to the bathroom, you know, an industrial hall. So they didn't have that. So I went to a liberal arts school called Ohio Wesleyan, and I studied with Tim Miller. He doesn't, but he comes and does workshops all over the country. And he did a week. Yeah, he did a week long workshop. And he saw that I did a whole piece about how, like, there wasn't space. Like, they accepted me into this program and gave me a scholarship for theater, but there wasn't, like, space for roles available to me because of the school. So I, like, sort of was lambasting him. That I created with him, and that he said, you don't have to wait for them. You can just make your own work. Mm-hmm. So, no. Every time I touch him, Mark, I got under the radar, Mark Russell was always like, I'm so happy, it's like full circle that I'm putting you in this, and like, Tim made you.
Open house? Cool. Just gonna do that. I mean, do you guys want to get introduced, Brian? How? Just want to start on stage? What are you guys want to do?
We're already here.
Yeah.
Great.
Let's
do that.
Tommy made a video. Yeah, Tommy. Tommy's the buster. Shit. Make a big entrance. Fantastic. Great. Yeah, so house is open. And we'll get started.
Well, it's time to have tea now.
That's a long conversation.
Right, Andrew said it doesn't have to be an hour.
Is this your first one?
Okay. So I'm just sort of. Hopefully, you can learn a little more. If not, we'll just converse. I mean, it's the two of you alone. That's fun. You know, I can like grace you with the rings too. But I'm excited. What's this? We're talking about the adventures. If you want. Yeah, we'll just read it up right down for the next one.
Yeah.
Cool. Tomorrow, I'm very excited. A friend of mine is doing some burlesque performance. His name is Jesse Lewis. Her persona is called Scribble. So, I'm very excited about that. To see that more. So, that is the next writing. I'm talking tomorrow.
We had 24 empty seats last night because it's
How are you? It's wonderful to have you with us today for our very first How Did You Make That panel with two illustrious guests, Tommy Kriegsman and Ariana Smart-Truman. I am Ryan Hedda. For those of you who don't know me, you probably don't know me, that's okay. I am a writer and performer. I've been in New York for about 2 years, and the most important thing that I have done so far is a solo show called Hi, Are You Single? Which is about sex and disability, and it was in Under the Radar 2017 as part of the Incoming series. And so Andrew, who curates the Incoming series with Mark Russell, who is here, how exciting, asked me to come because he thought that I was charming and funny and could moderate a conversation. So we have two wonderful individuals here. First, Tommy Kriegsman, who is the founder and president of Archetype, which is a management and production company that represents all kinds of game changers, tastemakers, major artists that are doing huge things on the fringes, off the fringes, emerging and established artists, and helping them get their work seen nationally and internationally, as well as here in New York. And Ariana Smart-Truman is the producing director of Elevator Repair Service, which has been around since 1981, is that correct? And you have been with it since 2005?
Yeah, 2005, 2006. I went on salary in 2006.
Yeah, that's a big distinction. It's very important.
Yes, it is.
Distinction. So we're going to have a conversation. I'm going to start with just a couple of very basic questions. Obviously, this is a festival that encourages and nurtures sort of DIY artists who are trying to make their own work and or producing and or observing or being scholars. So we're just going to start at a very base level, and then I'm going to encourage you all to ask questions to fill our time together. All right? So I'm going to start with a question for both of you, predominantly about the touring work that you do. Your companies are based here, like you two both are individually based here, but then a big part of your mission is to get your work seen outside of New York as well as in New York City. So when you first started in the touring business, what were the things that you hadn't initially thought about going into it that you would have liked to have known in the beginning in order to successfully make the tours work for your artists that you were representing or the work that you were making yourself?
Well, for Elevator Repair Service, John Collins, who's the artistic director, and I had both worked with the Wooster Group for a long time, so we had experience of touring, because that's a big part of what the Wooster Group does. So we had in our minds a model of how that works for an ensemble company to make work that's probably going to premiere in New York and then hopefully make money for the company by touring around the world, which enables the company to then be working on the next piece. So it's a sort of, certainly being seen by audiences around the world is important, but in a way it's kind of an economic imperative. In particular, a lot of those festivals and presenters in Europe and Australia can afford to pay artists a lot more than anyone in the United States thinks it's worth paying performing artists. So when I first went on salary with Elevator Repair Service, it was when GATS started touring. And GATS, Mark Russell, put in the Under the Radar Festival, the first edition at the Performing Garage. It was a secret underground performance, but luckily a lot of, because we didn't have the rights, technical detail. but so a lot of international presenters came and saw it, and it had its official premiere in Kunsten Festival in Brussels. So anyway, there were so many things that we didn't know about touring, and for us it was just so exciting that that the work was going to be seen. And even though we knew that this is a good way to make money, it was hard to figure out like what is it that you are charging for. And so really on just like a very basic level, figuring out you don't just get a presenter to pay for your direct expenses of the salaries of your artists or your airfare or your per diem, but sort of the meaning of everything that goes into the making of the piece. And in particular for an ensemble like ours, that takes an extremely long time to make a piece.
How long would you say?
Well, we say usually it's about 2 years. Gats was a little bit different. It was kind of 10 years in the making, really. And our model now is quite different than it was then with Gats. But with Gats, we just asked for enough money to sort of cover what was happening, and it didn't, not enough for the future. And Vallejo Gantner, who was at PS122 after Mark, was really helpful in helping us think about all of the things that went into this, and also, and something that I think about a lot now, is not just everything that went into making the piece, but an aspirational, what would have gone into making this piece if we were in a position to be able to pay ourselves salaries that were a living wage, and then charge for that. So that's a big part of it.
So you're sort of building toward, when you're building a fee, you're wanting to make space for the next piece, and the next piece, and the next piece. But in the beginning, you didn't have that future, that forethought to go all the way forward. That's fascinating. And how about for you? Did you start as an artist yourself, or did you start as representing other? Did you already know that you wanted? Let's talk about how your company formed first. That'll be my first question. It was 2005, it said, and what? Where did you see a need, and how did you aim to fill that need?
Mm-hmm. I knew so little going into it that it's really hard to imagine what kind of the goal was, except for a certain kind of functionality that I felt was necessary around how ensembles were coalescing resources to build their work and how that could happen. And there seemed to be a need around not just exposing the presenting industry, which even at that point, I still knew a very limited bit about. You know, you don't quite, going into it, it's hard to know how vast that network is and how many opportunities there actually are to kind of permeate that network and to figure out different ways of combining forces to get something done. And that's just something that you kind of learn as you're going along. There's not one book that has everybody in it. There's not one resource that has everybody there, you know, whether it's APAP or, you know, another kind of, you know, presenter-centric sales mechanism. It's still, there's no way to embody the entire picture of what is possible and who the players are and all of that. So, you know, but what I was really after at that point was that there were resources in the regional theater, there were resources internationally, and there were resources nationally, and how to figure out how to strategize through all of that for the building of a new work that allowed the most unique work possible to get made, or at least the most unique product to get made, and to really tune that to the artist rather than tuning it to what I thought at that time was really kind of just didn't quite understand how the theaters that I was working at wanted to build work that way. That seemed to be a bad way to build work, and I didn't like the product. So I was trying to figure out what then is the way to build the work, and what's the model and the structure around which you can allow work to get made. And that was, you know, that's not to say there was anything really cohesive about it. It was super slapdash, and you know, you're just kind of, as ERS would do at that time too, just kind of putting resources together as best as you can to do it all. And really what the the learning is about that in terms of producing is, you know, what exactly you're setting up, what the equation is that allows, you know, a structure and an environment and a process by which the artist can do the best work they can possibly do. At that point, what I was doing was probably not doing that. And as you get older and do more of it, you start to realize how you can, you know, what really is needed in the room at any given time that allows you to, that at least allows the artist, or is particular to the artist, that allows them to do the best work that they can.
And so when you're looking for touring venues for your specific artists that you represent, how do you we zero in on, oh, this institution is a good match for this ensemble, mm-hmm. or this institution is a good match for this artist. How do you do that matchmaking?
Yeah, I take a lot of time trying to get to know the presenter. I think that's a really, really key thing, which is a kind of an investment of time that certainly artists don't have time to do. You know, I think there's a certain, there's a kind of chance equation that allows you to be in a place where you are commonly around a bunch of presenters, or in those meetings, or in those conferences, or in those circumstances, that there are a bunch of presenters in the room, and you're sort of gauging and getting to know what it is, how they do, why they do it, why they make their choices, and how you can infect those choices, you know? So I think it's, the choices there are just, are getting to know sort of what the tiers and systems are, and that goes, you know, there are systems that are, you know, geographical, there are systems that are, you know, more or less tuned toward avant-garde and experimental work versus not, there are university systems whereby, you know, presenters have, you know, black boxes, mid-size and large-scale work, so, you know, you're really thinking about scale, you're thinking about economy, you're thinking about the aesthetic, you know, and all those things feed a practicality around, like, okay, this artist is good for this piece, and this artist, there, this presenter is good for this piece, and this presenter is not. And then, you know, from the beginning of a work, always for me is a kind of, in the conversation around a piece, at some point I see and can kind of see a kind of lineup, you know, I can mm-hmm. see a strategy, you know, where I can think about who this piece would appeal to and how that would work, and it's just a kind of a different way of, I think it's the presenter-centric way of formulating, you know, how a piece could exist and live, and building those strategies is what I do every day, you know,
recording
around that. you know, the touring piece with experimental work is about how to get a presenter involved as early as possible in the making of a work and get them aware and wedded somehow to that work. And then from there, you know, for better or for worse, they have to present it, you know? that's crucial. That's the crucial.
And do you do that with one presenter? Do you do that with five presenters?
Yes, but you know, as many as I can. You know, I mean, definitely depends on the scale of the work. Sometimes it's 2 to 3 presenters, and sometimes it's, you know, I'm in the middle of a piece right now strategizing around with Bryce Dessner, which is a, you know, a very different kind of conversation, because he's the guitarist of the National, for those who don't know, and he, you know, people want him in the room because he's bringing, you know, 10,000 people who know of him and know of his band, and they want to get to new audiences and new people with the work, so you know, that's going to involve 40 presenters in the building of that $1 million work, you know, and others that are, you know, it really just depends on the numbers and, if you know, how many it's going to take, you know, but the more presenters the merrier, because that's the life of the piece, right?
Of course.
So
Ariana, I want to ask a very interesting question, which you alluded to in your previous answer, that I went at the time we were working at the Garage performance space, you did not have the rights to Gatsby, and how and when was it determined, okay, now is the time, we have to actually get the rights to do this, and what was that process like? Because that sounds so utterly complicated to me, and it's a show that you continue to do, and the tours, and it's had multiple iterations in New York, so what is that conversation like with the rights holders, and how do you facilitate that as a producer?
Well, when Gas was being developed, I was not working with the company.
Sure.
And so John Collins was doing all of that negotiating, and I think looking back on it now, he would say he was a little bit naive. You know, I think he had a conversation with somebody affiliated with the Fitzgerald estate at Harold Ober Associates, who made it sound like, oh yeah, yeah, you could probably have the rights, and I think he thought, great, we have the rights, it's just technical. And then when it came right down to it, that person left Harold Ober, and John no longer had this person he'd been talking to, and they said, oh, sorry, the rights aren't available now that you actually have this engagement in New York. Somebody else has the rights. So it was never, it wasn't personal, it wasn't like, oh, we don't approve of what you're doing with the book. It was just, they signed a contract with somebody else, a playwright named Simon Levy, who had written an adaptation for the stage, and part of his contract said that nobody else could do a stage production during a certain number of years in New York. So we were able to get the rights to do it in Belgium. And at the time, there was all conversations with lawyers about fair use, or, you know, and John is a real legal nut, so he was really interested in having those conversations at great length with a lot of people. But what the main thing that we found out then, sort of going forward, is it's actually really simple. It's just about having straightforward conversations. And so since then, I've had to get the rights multiple times renewed for GATS. And when we were able to do it in New York, it was just that the agreement with Simon Levy had lapsed. And that's all. It was really just a technical thing. And have a nice relationship with the people who are the rights holders. And then I've had to do it with the Hemingway estate and also the Faulkner estate.
Sure.
And every estate, there's no standard. It's always just about trying to be clear. And of course, it helps a lot if you can say a couple of things. If you can say, we have an engagement at this place that's reputable, for instance, the Public Theater or New York Theater Workshop, and also we are reputable, you know, we've been reviewed in the New York Times, you can read about us, we're not, you know, hopefully we'll take your text seriously and treat it with a certain amount of reverence, and be able to be clear about what you want to do with it, and then also, most importantly, to say, we are a nonprofit, this is downtown. So you try to make yourself sound really big and important on the one hand, and then very, very poor on the other. And say, but we'd like to offer you $200. I usually say, we'd like to offer you $200 for the rights. And they say, no way, can you have, you know, The Sound and the Fury for $200? But then it ends up being not that much more than that, really, in the long term.
For the whole run.
Just to get the rights, and then usually a standard agreement is 6% of the gross box office. And that we have learned, that's another thing we learned from touring, was to make that the responsibility of our presenter. Because we are presented by other people, we have no control over what the box office is, right? You know, subsidized festivals might charge $10, 10 euros for a ticket, and the Public Theater might charge $190 for a ticket. So we make it the responsibility of the presenter to pay the royalties to the estates that we have negotiated the arrangements with.
Fantastic.
Keep them away from the fee. Yes.
Yes, and keep them away from the fee.
And so you say it probably had got easier after GATS because you had the press and, oh my gosh, you know, people said, oh, this is terrific, and it was getting all these amazing reviews. So then you could use that as leverage to the other estates, to Faulkner and Hemingway.
Yeah, although I think like the Hemingway, it's just a couple of lawyers. I've never met them. I picture them as being like in a Dickens novel, like 95 years old, sort of sitting in these old desks, what is this, you know, experimental theater, okay, it looks like you're not gonna hurt the reputation of this book, yes. So,
you know.
May I say a quick word? A lot about that process now. This is, you know, in some ways how one theater company's process can then feed into another theater company's process. Right now we're navigating 600 Howie Mandel's adaptation of Death of a Salesman. So that, which they did a long time ago, similar to what John did, they just kind of did it, you know, had maybe a big conversation some here or there, but felt like, maybe it's fair use, fuck it, and they did it. And immediately got their cease and desist letter after two performances down with the Lower Manhattan Cultural Council. But it was then, at that point, it was called This Great Country. And so now we are, and I think that Oscar was assisted a bit with the Hemingway, or the Fitzgeralds, and not really yet. Well, he's assisting greatly with this process now, and as is Mark Russell, and so we're looking at the future of that piece in a different kind of way, of course, because it's an actual adaptation of a script.
Is it too late to get the rights? Are they like, will they even talk to you?
It seems to be happening. I mean, eventually there's going to be a final verdict, but right now it all looks very promising. But the key issues there, of course, are, they're doing an adaptation of a script. You know, Arthur Miller's daughter, Rebecca, is not really there to or desires to authorize any adaptations of her father's scripts. And nor would he permit that, probably, if he were alive in any way. So there's a big decision that has to get made, and of course we're discussing that through a structure of, yes, it's only going to these experimental houses, yes, it's doing these limited runs, yes, it's festival-based, yes, it's nonprofit, yes, it's this, so that you get it all into one very peculiar corner of the world that they know it's going to have a very limited basis, and it's not going to open the can of worms where every regional theater, you know, director is going to say, oh, I'm ready to do my crazy version of Death of a Salesman that I've had in mind since college, and, you know, they get a bunch of calls on that front. So it's interesting.
And then it's your responsibility to keep that promise, right? To limit the scope of what it can become.
Totally. You've set the kind of parameter on that and then just keep trying to push it.
For sure. Yeah,
which is basically what producing is.
Ariana, you had said that at the GATS, in the GATS development period versus now, the model is very different. Can you talk to me about the evolution of ERS?
Yeah. When John started ERS in 1991, it was with a group of actors, friends who he'd gone to college with. And for many, many years, John's day job was the sound guy for the Wooster Group. Keeping ERS alive was like the nighttime. We all just donate our time, nobody gets paid, side gig. And at a certain point, John decided to really just commit himself to ERS and to find a way to raise enough money to pay himself a salary, a very small salary, but you know, just enough that it could be his job. And he did that maybe in, I'm not sure, 2002, something like that. And for a long time, it was just John and Tori Vasquez, and it was a very tiny little organization and trying to get these shows out there and touring. And GATS was just a really bizarre, unusual occurrence in the life of an experimental theater company, in that it was so popular with so many people. You know, it was critically acclaimed and audiences loved it and every festival wanted it and it toured everywhere. And once we figured out that we were charging like nowhere near, you know, the fee went from like really high. And it was a very expensive show for presenters to present, but they did. And so we were able to really solidify an administrative staff. And I came on and we got an office manager. So the administrative structure of the organization grew and was able to be sustained by the success of GATS. And the success of GATS meant that the next piece was sort of supported, like what Tommy was talking about, having people buy in before it's even made. We had 5 commissioners supporting The Sun Also Rises, the New York Theater Workshop co-produced The Sound of the Fury with us. All these things, people saying, like, whatever you do next, we're in, without knowing what it is, which had never been the case before. So having enough money to have enough people working to make more possibilities happen, it just grows and grows and grows, you know what I mean? So that's the main difference. If you don't have enough time to make any phone calls, then you're not going to get any gigs. But if you have enough money to pay somebody to make phone calls all day long, which is what I do, then you get more gigs. And then you have more money, and then you can make more shows.
Terrific. Tommy, I have one more question for you, and then we can open it up to questions from the audience. How do you establish relationships with artists or ensembles? Does the artist relationship come first, and then you work with them to develop a piece, or you've seen a piece of their work, and then you say, I want get involved with you as an artist? And on the second hand, how is your organization, how is Archetype different from a traditional sort of artist management or actor, playwright management kind of company?
I think it's really, really instinctual. And it always starts with a conversation with the artist. And if that feels right and there's a kind of fire there and we both feel comfortable with each other and there's a fundamental trust and feels like, you know, the goals are there and, you know, there's sort of a shared vision or sort of a passion about what the ultimate goals of the company are, then that feels exactly right and it feels very, very natural to enter into a relationship and start strategizing and dreaming together about what is possible. And that's really every artist relationship just happens that way, you know. Continues on for as long as that relationship can exist and feels viable and right, and then, you know, sometimes there's an eventual thing where the patterns of how that artist's work are get made and sponsored and supported change fundamentally, where I'm no longer necessary, And other times it continues on and the trajectory keeps working, and that's it. So there's always a constant kind of gauge around, am I functional? Or is the work that they're doing need someone like me, or does it not need someone like me? And that kind of fundamental need is, you know, drives the conversation from the very beginning. You know, there's certain artists who need a strategy like the one that I offer, and there are artists that do not need that strategy, or don't desire that strategy and want something to happen in a different way. Some artists want, you know, a kind of deeper, you know, it's me in my dining room, you know, is how I work, and sometimes a someone who helps me is there, sometimes they're not, and it's kind of a constant kind of balancing around the massive things that need to get done and the strategies that are at play at any given time. So, you know, sometimes artists just want more depth in that regard. They want to walk into a room and there are just more people sitting there and they can see a kind of different kind of efficiency than I can offer. And that's crucial for them in terms of how they want, and others are totally comfortable and like and are down with the way that I work, which is a bit more raw, let's say. And I think that's what makes it different than other artist management outfits that I know of who have a system, and I just don't have a system. I can't have a system. Me having a system is antithetical to how I want to make work and how I do that, and also just the way that the field changes and the frequency with which it changes, and that I have to be so observant all the time about how strategies are shifting and how funding models are shifting and where certain people are going and the personnel and how things are mixing and what, you know, just the fundamental changes around how sort of patterns are seeing their way through is part and parcel to how I think about everything every day. And I, you know, obviously other artist management facilities have that, but I think, yeah, I have mobility is what I need to do my thing.
Okay, now I think we're going to open up to questions from the audience. And somebody has a microphone. All right. So let's start. Oh, I'm supposed to tell you how to ask questions. we're not going to do commentary or compliments, even though we love compliments, we do. We only have about a half hour remaining together, so we want this to be very crisp and just be questions. So don't be afraid, you can ask anything you want. Nothing is off limits and nothing is too elementary. We're entering from a place of presumed, not everybody knows the answers. So everything can be asked, but you know, we don't want to hear your life story in connection to one of their pieces, okay? So, just questions. All right, let's start over there.
This is a question for Ariana. So you spoke about how early touring was necessary, really, to keep your coffers filled. And what I'd like to know is touring something that has value in itself and that you would want to continue to do, or now that the company's more successful, is it better to stay home? Thanks.
That's such a good question, Mom. yes, we absolutely. So because we're an ensemble, and because the way that we make work is by approaching a text as a group of people who know each other really well and who have all these kinds of shorthand of communication and shared experience. Touring is like an amazing way to bond a group of people. And we have, at this point, you know, decades worth of memories of being on the road together and being exposed to the work of other artists in other countries that we never would have seen in New York, which have informed our own artistic practice. And just what it means to see yourself as an American on a stage in another country over and over and over, and to be, you know, to receive the perception of yourself as an American and what that means, and to then turn that back on your own work. You know, so much of the work that we've done for those three novel pieces by those dead white men, Hemingway, Fitzgerald, and Faulkner, being able to really look at those from the eyes of the outside has been very important, and those pieces have continued to evolve because of that. So anyway, there's many, many reasons. And also now that a lot of us have kids and the kids are getting older, it's a really fun way to go on vacation with either with your child or without your child. I'm gonna bring my daughter to New Zealand in February, which is great.
Can I, I'm gonna follow up to that. If you, when you, because you have families, do you factor that in to the fees associated?
Yes, we do. Elevator Repair Service has always made a huge commitment to making it possible for the lives of the ensemble members to change and not mean that they have to withdraw from working on the work. And so from, we have all kinds of policies in place as a company. For instance, if anyone has a child who's under two or is still breastfeeding and we go on tour, then the company pays for that child and for a care provider to come with them. And if that child is over the age of two, but the parents want the child with them, then we talk about, well, what do we need to do? How can we help? And we'll pay for half of your caregiver to come or whatever. And we pay for childcare frequently. If somebody comes to us and says, I want to be in this piece, but if I'm rehearsing at night for 4 or 5 week periods over the next, you know, 18 months, it doesn't make sense for me. And we say, well, let's talk about how much you're spending on childcare and how much can we contribute. So we make all kinds of commitments to making being a parent not be the thing that prevents you from being able to be an artist.
That's wonderful. Others?
Can you talk a little bit about, I guess in terms of touring, in terms of the different spaces, I feel like a lot of us do a lot of hybrid work, and so I felt like there's a lot of opportunities for it to be in a lot of different places, whether it be theater or like a music venue, or have you found the landscape change within the last couple of years of being able to, I guess, kind of do pieces in not unexpected places, but places that necessarily weren't considered where you would normally do your show at?
Yeah, it doesn't get any easier, I think, when you're working with an artist who has a desire to create a very specific kind of work that goes to certain kind of places and plays in certain kind of venues, and to go on that strategy to source who the partners are for that and where the money is for that doesn't get any easier. You know, you wind up falling back on, just out of necessity, partnerships that might make that viable. For example, if, you know, someone has a desire to do, you know, a piece that is gonna absolutely has to play in, you know, arboretums in small towns, or wants to play on farms, you know, or wants to play in very, let's say it's, you know, only, you know, high schools, or, you know, wants to do some very, very specific kind of site-specific deal. Typically, I'm still falling back on, okay, well, who's the local presenter out of there who can act as a, you know, a core of that and can help us find the regional partners that can allow that to happen and will be interested in making that happen. There aren't a lot of people who are interested in doing that because there are so many factors around audience building and how they can mechanize that more or less makes sense for them. And then going into the other approach where you're going into communities and you're trying to find a funding base that can allow this piece to exist is another piece of it. I think there's another factor about what you're talking about in the kind of music world of combining a more kind of commercial versus nonprofit sector, maybe to some degree. For example, my answers are gonna be all so specific about like what piece, you know, you're talking about in a way, because it's hard for me to think in the abstract about that because in a larger way, but some artists that I'm working with of late could be playing at a concert hall, you know, in a town, get in the morning, load in like a band, sound check, go. You know, and it might be a multimedia piece and it happens. So I can go to a concert promoter, I can go to a presenter, I can go to, you know, another kind of venue or avenue, and I can build a strategy and a tour around that. I think people are more receptive to that than they were years ago. You know, I think that you've got, I think the music business particularly is looking for ways to break out of, you know, the kind of infection and control that AEG and Live Nation and others are putting onto these venues, and they're looking for ways to break out and find new stuff that they can be in control of again, and I think that there's an opportunity there to do that, but it's still the money almost never works out, you know, based on their models, which is like, okay, you get 80%, we get 20%, go, and then you have to count on their marketing systems, you have to count on their base for that, and then, you know, for them to intelligently staff that piece so that the production costs don't get too high. You know, these are all the things that, you know, I'm thinking about along with the artists to make sure that that there's creativity around that. Does that sort of answer your question?
Yeah, I mean, I think that just in terms of some of the work, I've had conversations about, well, where can we do this at? Can we do this in an art gallery? Can we do this in a music venue? Can we do this also in a theater?
Right.
Is there, is it about us creating a different kind of iteration for that? But just wanting to try to be flexible and try to do it in a lot of different interesting places, because some of the work is very hybrid, where it's like it has music to it and it has, you know, so that we're not just stuck in like a theater space.
Yeah, and every time I'm thinking about that, I'm thinking about what they're basically the programming systems in and around each one of those venues are, right? Because a gallery is programming 3 or 4 years out,
yeah.
A music venue is programming 2 to 3 months out, and a venue is, you know, programming, you know, nonprofit typical performers a year to a year and a half out. So how do you balance through all those things? Some pieces, you know, can afford, want that gallery partnership and want a concert partnership, and then also have a theatrical arm to it. And I'm trying to bring 3 or 4 entities together in one city. You know, again, that works, but I wouldn't, like, I'm, you know, 2-3 years out. You know, there's a time kind of strategy that has to say, okay, but we're really talking about, we have to consider everybody's system in that and how we bring it together, and that's just time at that point, you know.
I think also the universities can be a little bit more open, although universities can be very bureaucratic and feel very slow moving. On the other hand, because they have all these different departments that can come together, it's part dance, it's part performance, it's part, you know, community outreach, that it's a way of different departments coming together and pooling their resources. They often each have very limited budgets at universities for presenting. But if they can kind of all combine together and then say, hey, we're going to do it in the library, you know, I find that universities can be good places for that kind of, and I don't know if that's new, but in my experience there, they can be very open.
Venues, presenters need to have things to fill in their space.
What's your position on that? How do you approach that? Since you know that they need as well as you need, you both have a common need.
Right. Okay, so there, it starts with the kind of systems that are in place within the conference system that someone like me uses to get to people. Those sales conferences happen in September and they're regional, and then you've got APAP in January, and then there are international conferences and other things. And that's a place to go where I can sit down and know that there are a few hundred people around me that I can access at any given point. And some of them are going to be more or less interested in talking to someone like me, because I'm always bringing something very edgy to them. And then the second part of it is, you know, just really looking strategically from the beginning of what you're doing that has either a thematic, geographical, or some cultural, or you know, some sort of aesthetic base that has a certain applicability to some subset of presenters, and then you go to that subset of presenters and you say, okay, how do I best present this piece? You know, is it through, you know, an email? Do I have to travel to them? Is there a fancy dossier? Do I have to come up with a bunch of sort of multimedia magic that's going to turn them on to this piece? So there are many different approaches to how that is, but they're all based in trying to figure out who the applicability is to and what the piece relates to and getting to them somehow. Again, time is a massive factor with that, allowing yourself enough time to do it. Don't be, you know, naive enough to think that if you're trying to get something done in 6 months from now that there's any rationale behind doing that. You've got to give it that time and ability to do so. That's the common mistake, you know, through, I think, every strategy and artist that I'm dealing with. The other one, of course, is, hey man, we just finished this run. It went so well. Can you work with us? You know, and it's like, dude, you're done with the run. We needed to think about this a year ago, and how are we going to show this piece to people, especially the more experimental presenters who had to see it live in order to program it. It's done. The opportunity's gone. move on to the next and start thinking about how you're going to use that strategy to the next piece. You know, so I think there's this kind of common theme around, you know, for someone like me sitting in a place that says know your presenter, know your presenter, know your presenter, gets to kind of sit all day and think about that and get and email constantly people, try to get them on the phone to talk about them through work, get to know them, get to know their approach, get to know what that lights their fire, and then consistently try to think about how to get something to them that works for them and their, you know, their season or their program or their, you know, ideas and universities and environments and neighborhoods and, you know, their local culture that applies. And then, you know, it's as you're considering, for better or for worse, what starts to happen is that you then start to conceive of work or working relationships that feed that big beast somehow, right? And that's, you know, is that good or bad? I don't really know. I mean, should artists just create and not think about that and then let the work have its life? Or should artists be really thinking about what its life and its life potential is and create in accordance with that? I think that artists who are doing well in those spheres are thinking about the market. I think they are, whether they know it or not. You know, I think that's part of what they're doing. And they're thinking about the applicability of that work and how it's going to find its place there. Because the artists that I know who are, you know, moving through those systems are doing it really, really well and with charm and a lot of strategy and personal strategy with those presenters and those venues. And you know, so I think that there's, you know, as they consider their work, whether they're doing it for audiences or whether they're doing it for presenters or thinking about how that work is going to fit, like the entire sphere is feeding the what and why they do what they do. If there's alignment, then that work is going to have a big, long life. If there's not, it's going to have a brief one.
Other questions? We have about 15 minutes left.
There's one thing that I just thought of when you asked your question, which I'm not sure if this is an answer, but that issue of that the presenters need the artists and the artists need the presenters, I think is sometimes a revelation to artists. Mm. And I teach a workshop on touring, and especially for younger artists or companies just starting out, to say, you are not in the one down position here. You're on an equal negotiating field. And I think so often to artists, it feels like this institution has the money and they have the power and they have the audience, and that's what I want, so that people can see my work. I just have this thing which is I have only the work, but actually that thing does not exist without the work. And so I think you can really relax as an artist when you're in a negotiation, remembering that without your art, they've got nothing. So that I think that's a nice point to remember.
I wonder, based on what both of you have said, Tommy just said that you can't entice certain organizations to present you unless they've seen it live. So you need to be thinking ahead of time how to make the impact, how to make the splash. And I know that particularly some of your shows, I was looking at your timeline, and Gats is the one that was just in New York again and again and again and again and again until finally it was at the Public, and then it went back to the Public.
It was only in New York once in 2005, and then it came to the Public in 2010 and then 2012.
So,
but it was all over the world between 2005 and 2010.
And that was how it was making its splash through.
I mean, Oscar wanted it from the very beginning at the Public, but we just didn't have the rights. But when the rights finally came through, we were able to bring it into New York.
But I guess my question is, are you careful with extinguishing the fire of a piece before, you know what I mean? Making sure that the momentum builds and that you haven't sort of lost an opportunity.
No, there's just no standard. There's no one way to do anything. And so, for instance, GATS, people still want that show. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have requests right now, very serious requests from huge presenters on, you know, four different countries on three continents who still want GATS. So like that flame will never be extinguished.
Got it.
And then the Select, The Sun Also Rises, we premiered in Edinburgh in 2010, And we kind of thought like that'll have like a tour, you know, it has like go like this, and then the touring kind of tapers off as presenters around the world say like, oh, that's the old show. But you know, we're still touring that. We just did a 7-week run in Washington, D.C. We're going to New Zealand in February. So it's like if people love the work, then they'll want
they'll
that.
Keep wanting.
Yeah, and you can't make a present. In very few instances have I been able to persuade a presenter to take one piece over another. They want what they want for some particular reason. And you know, there are presenters out there who say, I love you as an artist and I'll take whatever you've got next. But it's pretty rare that somebody as a presenter can afford to say that. And they you know, they're, oh, my festival this year is about bridges, or you know, they always have like some theme or whatever, you know. And I can see how this piece, you're bridging that cultural gap or whatever, you know, like they make it work for themselves, whereas your other piece, they don't see where the bridge is, so they don't want that piece. So, you know.
So you have to sort of roll with the punches and just take.
You do.
And not, you can't say this is the shelf life, because some people will still want.
Yeah, I had somebody just say to me the other day, oh, you just tell them, that show's not available. This is the show we've got now. It's not up to me. I can't say that. And for us, we're lucky that we can keep our shows alive for as long as we do, because we work with an ensemble and we can keep calling on those same actors.
Terrific. And for you, when you're starting with an artist who has a piece that's coming, how do you, what are some tips if they don't have somebody as resourceful and as exciting working from their dining room table to make those things happen? How can artists and young producing entities start to take the steps to make the impact that will last, instead of saying, oh, it already happened, okay, do you want to look at it? On a video?
I don't know, because I'm not an artist. I don't know if it's fundamentally helpful for an artist to think about the goals of a work at the beginning of the work or not. It's probably not. But to somewhere in the back of your mind, I think as an artist, you have to know what you'd like this piece to do. You know, and I think that again, for better or for worse, that's going to feed how you're structuring that piece. If you are considering that you want that piece to go on the road, then as you're thinking, considering your designs, then you need to really think about how mobile that set is, you know, and how realistic it is to bring 5 people on the road versus 25 people on the road as a new artist. You know, it's I think most often lightning strikes where it's like, okay, we've got this amazing piece, we're doing it with, you know, a couple of people, like Jen Kidwell's here from Underground Railroad Game, and a variety of other amazing work, and you know, the success of that piece, and I'm working with that now, and we're strategizing around, and there's so many interesting complications around that piece because it is so brave and so beautiful that it takes presenters a while and needing to observe others and how they handle it and how they do it and present the work, that it's sort of how to kind of stoke those fires. But you know, I think within that creation process, there was automatically mobility. That company is creating a certain way that they're not going to go to a regional theater, sit down, and put a massive set together that allows that piece to live in that in one way. They're thinking already about the mobility of that work and how it can apply. So that by the time Ars Nova came to it, I think they were able to fund it to a way where, like, oh, look, we have got this, you know, we've got the set, we've got these things going on. And you know, then there's a structure that exists whereby that piece can now move forward, and we're constantly navigating how it does so in a way that allows it the longest life it possibly can. So I think there's a logistic to it that is crucial to understand from the beginning of a process, that if your goals are the work to move, then create it so that it's mobile. You know, if it's not, and you've got a whole another goal in mind, accept the fact and understand that while you may strategize toward presenters to come see the piece, and while you may strategize toward the market to be exposed to the work, that there are going to be parameters around that that you're going to know, that are going to be apparent, you know, very clearly from a logistical standpoint, from a financial standpoint, that are going to maybe limit it, you know, and build accordingly. So I think that's always where a producing partner, at least they can be thinking that way.
Yeah.
And can feed that information at certain strategic times so that the artist can consider that as they're going. And then the artist doesn't have to think about that themselves, which I think is, you know, can potentially be corrosive for them to think of it that way. You know?
Great. Does anybody have any other questions? We have about 5 minutes. If not, we can, oh, great, perfect.
Hi. So this is a kind of a huge question, but maybe you can condense it into some pithy observations. And sort of for both of you, have you recently become aware of any differences in the presenting environment regarding like what kinds of work gets supported and availability of funding and all of that that specifically are the result of the current political climate in the U.S. Do you feel like there's a connection between what's going on politically in the United States with regard to those resources in this country and also maybe even outside of the country, or is it like, or are they somehow separate worlds? So I'm curious to know about your experience, what the barometer is right now.
I mean, most people plan what they're presenting far enough in advance that I don't think we would see the correlation yet. So quickly. I mean, I think in general, presenters have been, in my experience, moving a lot more towards anything that has an aspect of community engagement. That's become very important, which I have sort of mixed feelings about personally. But I think it's important, but I also think artists should be allowed to practice art for art's sake. But especially in light of the current administration, I do think it's ever more important to have that kind of dialogue and to use artistic practice as a way to talk about what's happening in the world. But I don't actually see an immediate difference yet, personally. Do you?
I guess my my fundamental criticism of you know, the performing arts in general is that they're always, at least when it comes down to, I think, theater and dance, and is that it's always so far behind the current, right? And when you, the beauty of working with music is that you're right there all the time, and like music can move very, very quickly, and new music can get made, and the producing process and how that all works with composers and new music, just because of the minimalism of that creation process, of them being around a computer in a room with their instruments and their band and their producing process, can happen very quickly, so they can respond very, very quickly to the events that happen within the sort of theater and dance module. It's like all these things are going down in America, and it's really hard to look around and see now what the theater and dance has to say to it in an immediate sense. Like, we need a year to build that shit. You know, we need 2 years maybe. We need to like begin now and think about the process and then dramaturg it, and then it's, you know, what's going to happen is eventually there's going to be a response to all this, but it's going to happen in a while, you know, for us to reflect on and be able to process that. In other circumstances, like with Jen's Underground Railroad game, you know, who knew how pointed that conversation around whether, you know, there's really been an end to the Civil War was going to be this year. And then, boom, there's Underground Railroad game talking about just that and how that has just not stopped ever. And here we are, you know, with a president who sucks that bad that we have to, you know, be engaged in this conversation and really, really question that on a much broader scale than we were before. You know, so I think there's a chance mechanism around, you know, how applicable and politically concise the work is at any given time, you know, a more or less intellectual distance around how the work is being created with its immediacy and how audiences are perceiving it. You know, another thing about being as impoverished as our worlds are, and how we create work, and the I think very, very disastrous, very difficult circumstances in which artists are forced to make work right now, is you know, is really how they can do that in a way that is accessible, I guess is one word for it, but I'm really just talking about immediacy and sort of where people can relate to that work in the most immediate sense possible, which I think is so crucial and important right now. And I, you know, looking around at where dance is at and where theater is at, and the kind of knowledge you need to bring to a room in order to understand what's going on in front of you is difficult, I think, is a challenge, I think is a problem. I'm more critical of that, but that comes from my head of talking in any given day with presenters from LA, presenters from London, presenters from Australia, and presenters from Kansas City, and around Texas and Florida and others, and just hearing how all these folks are seeing the work that's applicable to them and really wanting something that can transform and change and have as wide an impact as possible is my feeling on that. And that, look, that just, you know, it constantly changes. It constantly changes, you know.
Okay, oh, I think, do we have time for one more? Or do we need to?
I think we need to.
Okay, cool. Go ahead.
On the topic which we're just talking about, are you finding a self-censorship coming about in the more venues or presenters? And are you finding a underground railroad for artists who are really saying something that is not the status quo?
I guess, again, it comes a bit from the kind of origin and intent of the artist and the piece of how either deceptive or subtle they're being with what they're talking about. I think it's you know, the artist is either positioning something in a very, very big, loud way that's talking to audiences and, you know, in as is high impact way, or they're doing it in a way that is a bit more it's sort of a quiet rebellion that's really meant to kind of plant a seed that's gonna you know, work its way through your life in another way after you get away from the show for a while. And I think you know, there's a bit of a poison, you know, always, that in the more kind of cosmopolitan areas, you know, New York, Seattle, Chicago, Boston, New York, Austin, a certain work is going to happen and it's going to thrive there, and it's only going to thrive there. It's not going to reach the in-betweens and all of that. That's problematic to me, hugely problematic to me. And I'm always trying to push presenters that I'm in conversation with and, you know, trying to just kind of set an example with the work that I'm caring about and advocating for, that they take a risk on that. But it's hard. I do see presenters really, really very, very seriously running and hiding from work, big way, no fucking question. They are not programming things that are going to upend the systems and are going to force them to lose their jobs. They're not. And that's to me, you know, I don't know what to say about that. I mean, I care about them and want to protect them, and it's also like, God damn it, motherfucker, if you don't do it, who the fuck's going to do it? Please, please support this work. They can't take a risk unless you encourage that risk. So, you know, it's hard. It's hard.
Okay, we have to wrap, but thank you to Ariana and Tommy. And I know that you both have things that are happening or coming up, and yours is sold out, but still talk about it for just a second.
We have Measure for Measure at the Public Theater running until November 12th. It is basically sold out, but people get in every night with rush tickets or off the standby list, so it's worth going down because you can get in.
Yes, and you have postcards.
Yeah, I actually do, but I just got with that. Anyway, the Freedom Theater from Janine Palestine opens next week on October 12th through 22nd at NYU School of Arts. Piece called The Siege, worth seeing.
Thank you both. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for everyone attending, and thank you, Ryan, for moderating our panel today. Stick around, we have a great talk with Peter Episol, new dramaturgy's event about new media, in this room in a few minutes. So if you don't have anywhere to go, please stick around. Thanks. Thank you.